Welcome to Conversations with Zaki Baruti. This is your host, Zaki Baruti. We welcome you again into our program that we know will be very exciting this evening as well as interesting. I want to first of all give a shout out to my biological family. Hey, what's going on to the Universal African People's Organization family, as well as to New Life Evangelistic Center and led by Reverend Rice, as well as to the people behind the camera, Bill and Bob. Tonight's guest is a good dear friend and a person who's out on the front line trying to make a difference for our community, and that's Mr. Adolphus Pruitt, president of the local chapter of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP. Welcome to Conversations with Zaki. How you doing, sir?
Okay, we're going to have a good one, too.
We are going to have a good one. Okay, then. First of all, you know, Brother Adolphus, I always open up my program with my guests to kind of let the people know who that person is, you know, in terms of some background information, you know, where you grew up at, school, you know, wherever you want to share with our millions of folks that's out there listening at Channel 24 tonight.
Millions.
Oh, yeah.
I agree. That's okay, good. Then. That's good. You know, Zaki, I was born and raised here in St. Louis, born at Holman Phillips Hospital back in the late 50s. Lived all over St. Louis, went to public schools, came out of a first class of Visual Performing Arts High School. Left here, went to Tuskegee for a little while. Sired my first child, came home, went to Missouri Baptist University, graduated from Missouri Baptist, started a business back when I was 22 years old. I went in business when I was 22 for myself.
What kind of business was that?
Actually, in the cosmetic business.
Oh, okay.
A friend of mine had invented a facial moisturizer, and we tried to put it on the marketplace. Did a good run at it, but all of Olay beat us. Did that and did a lot of real estate development, started working with managing nonprofits. I ran the Ville organization for years. Most of the housing and redevelopment happened over there. I did over in the 21st Ward, in the O'Fallon neighborhood. I did all of that. As a matter of fact, we the ones who brought lease purchase homes using low-income housing tax credits to the city of St. Louis. We the first ones to ever done that. Matter of fact, we did the largest low-income housing tax credit project that's ever done by minorities at that point in time in the city of St. Louis.
And this was under what auspices?
This was, we had O'Fallon 2000, and then we did the building there at Fair in Lexington.
Okay.
That was back in the 80s. At the same time, I tried to do a black museum. I never forget the old police station at Page and Union. Tried to convert that into a black museum back in, that was in the early 80s. Took on that fight. That's how I first got to know. Vervis was the chairman of the Automatic Black Caucus, and Steve and Mike Roberts was on the board then. Wayman was still on the board.
So that's kind of going way back into the history of black politics in St. Louis.
Oh man, yeah, I was 27 years old, and most of the folks that are in and out now, I knew them, you know, way back. Matter of fact, Greg Daley was Tom Zisch's chief of staff. That's when I first met Greg Daley.
And so, Greg Daley is right now
he's the collector of revenue.
Right, right.
Yeah,
right.
So I mean, I'm way back. Francis was board of an alderman. Old man Clay, Clay Senior was still committee man.
Okay.
Over there.
So this led kind of like in the interaction with politicians as well as development of the community. Mm-hmm. I guess fast forward it. In terms of your civic involvement.
I always looked at a lot of that as being civic, but you're right. So what happened was one day somebody asked me to get involved with the NAACP, and I told them no. I thought the organization was irrelevant, and they told me it is because folks like me won't get involved, so I joined.
Okay.
And that was about 10 years ago.
Okay, that's in your first. Was that your first civic organization actual been involved with?
No, I was involved with the what was it the the library expansion group way back, the Centennial Group way back then I was involved in, the Technical Assistance Corp. A lot of the organizations I was a part of.
Okay, then, so you joined the NAACP about 10 years ago. Yeah. When did you become president?
About 4 or 5 years ago. Okay, I'm going to my 6th year.
So you're in your 6th year, and one of the things I want to do during this program is kind of look at some of the major issues that your organization is undertaking.
Sure.
And I know at this present time, your organization is involved with the community benefits agreement with the company MSD, Metropolitan Sewer District.
Yes.
And I want to, how long has that benefit been, that agreement? What is that community benefits agreement, first of all?
It's we're going on, I guess, maybe our 3rd year. And what happened was after MSD had completed their disparity study, we, instead of just accepting the study as it was, what we did was negotiated with MSD to create a document that would basically outline the steps that MSD was going to take to cure the issues that came up in the disparity study and to implement those recommendations. Because the disparity study determined that in some areas, minority contractors and workforce were not participating at the level we wanted to see.
And so in terms of a disparity study, I want our people to be real clear,
right?
What is that? And what we're going to do is look at that on the flip side of our break.
Today, we're distributing hundreds of bus tickets to homeless people in downtown St. Louis, going out onto the streets and also water, chips, and doing surveys to find out what other needs they have that New Life Evangelistic Center can meet, since they've given us that cease and desist order at 1411 Locust Street. So we're moving right out on the streets. In addition to that, perhaps you didn't even know that we do have a new newspaper. This is the Cry Justice Now Street News, and a cry for justice as the homeless are put back out onto the streets, and got some really neat articles in here about the homeless being arrested near the main library, homeless individuals talking about how they've been harassed more by the police, and actually some facts that you're not reading about in your other local paper or hearing on the news. Talks also, and as it's directed to the homeless, about the leadership training program opportunities available at New Life Evangelistic Center, testimonies from those that are in that training program, plus stories from people that are out on the streets. And then I've got an article here, Rally at the Cross, and a story from volunteers and the like. So if you'd like a copy of this issue, call us. Just telephone operator. I'd like a copy of the Cry Justice Now Street News. And if you'd like to volunteer as we go out on the streets now, as we're ministering more out on the streets, we have teams that are going out every day, call us at 421-302. That's 421-302. Now, all this is possible because of those of you that are donating to the New Life Evangelistic Center at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, at 63166. I'd like to just also add a word that New Life is not just involved in the downtown area. There are so many exciting things that are taking place through the work of New Life Evangelistic Center. Our administrative offices are now at 2428 Woodson Road in Overland, Missouri. We have our renewable energy offices that are there. Just a lot of exciting things that are going on that facility. And then also the training farms that we have. For example, in New Bloomfield, Missouri, out there we have 15, 16 homeless men that are learning radio broadcasting skills. They're learning renewable energy. They have their cattle operation, livestock production that's out there. Their energy shows out there. A lot of things happening in New Bloomfield, Missouri. And in Marshfield, Missouri, my son Chris, his wife Martha, and their children are out there, along with a number of the homeless people that are getting training in renewable energy and working with the sheep and the chickens and the free store out there. That's in Marshfield, Missouri. Homeless married couples out there, a couple of homeless women, they're learning radio. We've got three of the homeless men that are in our energy center, some actually living off-grid. And then we have Joe Batson that's also working in Springfield, Missouri, and the work that's going on and with the team that's going on there, the largest daytime walk-in shelter for the homeless in southwestern Missouri, northwestern Arkansas. They're in Springfield. And then Ralph Case and his team down in Van Buren, and then there's free stores located at many locations. So again, for further information on this, go to the New Life website, www.newlifeevangelisticcenter.org. But again, I want to mention the newspaper, and if you want to get a copy of it, just call us at 421-3020. And while you're calling, why don't you volunteer to help out? That's the Cry Justice Now Street News, and it goes into a lot of stories, things that are happening downtown after the city of St. Louis to close down the 1411 Locust facility. So again, get in touch with us. Contact us now if you'd like a copy of this. And please continue to keep New Life Evangelistics in your prayers. We're able to reach out all over Mid-America to the hurting and the homeless because of those of you that are supporting this work. And it's P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri. That's 63166. That's where you can send your tax-deductible gifts. Or give online through the PayPal system at newlifeevangelisticcenter.org. A lot of exciting things happening through the work of New Life Evangelistic Center. So continue to keep praying for us as we keep moving forward to the glory of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
We're back with Conversations with Zaki Barut. And in studio with me is my guest, Adolphus Pruitt, the president of the local chapter of the NAACP. On the other side of the break, we were just getting into what is a disparity study. And that was what was done in terms of for job development at MSD or the projects that were to be coming down. Yeah, and so, again, MSD being the Metropolitan Sewer District.
So what happened, and happened years ago out of a case in Richmond, the Supreme Court ruled. And what it basically said is if it's a public entity and there's public dollars involved, that you can in order to ensure that those dollars are being spent in an equitable way with all everybody, with all populations, that those entities can underdo or undertake what they call the disparity study. And what this study does is look at how they spend their dollars, who they spend their dollars with, look and see who's available, what companies are available, and see if the dollars being spent are being spent equally based on the amount of companies that are available. In other words, if there's a 100 black companies in the city of St. Louis who are willing and able and ready to participate in construction work, and then they're spending and they represent 20% of all of the business that are available, then that means when 20% of all of the dollars spent on construction should go to that group of people. If not, say they're only getting 10% of the dollars, then that means there's a 10% disparity. And by law, once that study is done, it proves that that disparity exists, quantify that it exists, then it gives those groups and the public the ability to ask the courts to intervene and right the ship or balance it out if the entity that did the study won't do it on their own. And so once we did that, we started actually about 5 years ago and said our goal was to make sure every public entity in this region undergoes a disparity study so we can finally deal with this issue of minorities getting their fair share. So the MSD was first, then we got the city.
So now when you say we, so that was like the NAACP leading that charge.
Yeah, absolutely. And
so first of all, to create a disparity study with the different public entities that are spending public dollars. And one of them has been the MSD. And what other?
The City of St. Louis. St. Louis Counties is underway now. The St. Louis Community College has done one. You know, we're making every public entity do one.
So going back to the MSD, as an extension of that disparity study, in what year did the community benefits agreement come into existence? And that
December 15, right in that area, the end of 2014, going on December 15.
And that position was to what?
And that position, and the CBA was to say that MSD had goals that says 33% minorities should be participating in the workforce with the private sector that provide professional services. So the community benefit agreement gave us ability to say, here, to agree with them on here's the methodology you're going to use to increase those numbers, and here are the reporting mechanisms that you're going to put in place so that you can let the community, let the people who signed on the benefits agreement know what's going on. It gives us the ability to go in there and ask for documents and do things like that. And that's how we got to where we are now with MSD as relates to the dispute, because...
Okay, before we get into where we're at now, and again, I just want for the people a clear process. So you enter into a community benefits agreement with MSD as one of the public entities. Were there a number of organizations that was part of
Absolutely.
That, or was that just the NAACP?
No. It's NAACP, MOCAN, CORE, M Slice, I mean,
eventually our organization also.
It's about eight different organizations.
Now, when you entered into MSD, so the disparity study did show that there was...
Absolutely.
Okay, so that was in the year 2015.
Right.
Fast forward in terms of, and how many dollars vastly are we talking about in terms of for MSD?
The community benefits agreement covers the expenditures that must occur under the consent decree MSD had entered into with the EPA to fix the sewer system. And right now, that total project costs over the next 20 years, we're in the year four or five of it, three or four now. Is a little bit more than $2 billion, $2.5
billion. $2 billion being spent on infrastructure of the MSD, and the community benefits agreement is saying and pushing that a fair share of that should come to people who look like you and I. Is that correct?
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay,
has there been progress? Do you feel that the MSD has been moving forward toward making... Well, first of all, were they there when you first entered into the agreement?
No, they weren't there when we entered into it. And as we moved forward after about a year or so, they still weren't hitting the marks the way we thought they should. So, of course, we accused them of being in default of the agreement, which caused us to begin to become adversarial with MSD and demand certain documents, certain studies. And as we got stuff back in, for us, it proved that we were right, that while MSD was having participation, it was not occurring at the level that we think it should, and the change was not occurring at the pace that we think it could based on our experience. And since then, of course, they've speed up the pace, but it's been 2 years of fighting to get that done.
So would you say then we are close as a community benefits agreement to getting to the point of making them do the right thing?
Or? Absolutely. I would say that MSD is operating at 100% better than they were when we first started. It's about getting the things done. But remember, we had to first discover that things still weren't going the way they need to. Then we had to go into this prolonged battle with MSD over the past year and a half to get them to speed up and put certain things in place. And so the concern is that what can we get put in place now where we don't have to continue to look over their shoulder to make this happen? I don't think there is anything. I think we're going to always have to look over their shoulder.
Okay, so with that point, we'll come back with further discussion about the kind of work that the NAACP is doing.
For just 80 cents a day, you can help many people in need all around the world. That's only $24 a month. The New Life Evangelistic Center wants you to help feed the hungry and shelter the homeless by joining Club 24. For $24 a month, you can be a part of touching people's lives. For just 80 cents a day, you can make a difference in someone's life. Call 314-881-3210 or give online at newlifeevangelisticcenter.org.
When you spread out your hands in prayer, I will hide my eyes from you. Even if you offer many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Learn to do right. Seek justice. Encourage the oppressed. Defend the cause of the fatherless. Plead the case of the widow.
When I was hungry, New Life Evangelistic Center has fed me. When I needed clothes, he clothed me. And when I needed a bed to sleep in, he also provided that. And I'm grateful, very grateful, to New Life Evangelistic Center.
You all are just blessed, and we just need, help sometimes.
I thank the Lord for Larry Rice because he helped many of people like me that's on disability, needing help. Without him, I don't know what I would do.
If you need help, you come down here and they will help you. That's all you have to do.
We found ourselves nowhere to go, and New Life was an independent shelter, which means, you didn't have to go through the Housing Resource Center. You could just come in.
They helped me, to keep me off the cold, give me a place to sleep, eat. They clothed me, and they helped me solve my problems.
Welcome back to Conversations with Zaki Baruti. We are here in studio with us is an activist with the St. Louis chapter of the NAACP, the president, in fact, Adolphus Pruitt. Welcome back again. Sure. Bringing that discussion around MSD to a close, MSD covers St. Louis City and St. Louis County, am I correct?
St. Louis City and St. Louis County.
And one of the things that our organization has always been pushing is that whatever percentage that we are of taxpayers, we should be getting those goods and services back from government and public entities. Mm-hmm. What would you say is the percentage of blacks in the metropolitan area? Would you offer
even
a guess?
When you combine, even though we're the majority of the population in St. Louis, when you combine St. Louis and St. Louis County, look at the population, somewhere between 22 and 28%, I believe, overall.
Okay, then. So you accept the position then, if it's about that, a best guess, that we should be receiving those kinds of economic from. Okay, then. In terms of will there be any kind of community forum to let the people know once you are satisfied or the community benefits agreement is satisfied that MSD is living up to its responsibility?
Yeah, I think we don't have a choice but to once we get closer to finalizing all the other things, as along with MSD, us jointly along with MSD, put out a final report to the public and to all of the ratepayers that basically says, here's what we spent, here's who's got it, and here's where we're trying to go. And that way we all now are on the same page as relates to where we are right now. And then we can see whether that continues to climb, or we can all see whether it declines, whether it starts to fall.
Well, we got to make sure it keeps them declining.
Right. Well, I mean, but my point is now we all can monitor it.
Right. Now, I know as a national organization, there's other critical issues that the NAACP is taking. Do you want to address, what would you say, especially with the advent of the new president of the United States and many people being concerned that voting rights won't be under attack, police won't be allowed to run rapid? Give us your assessment in terms of the position of the NAACP on those two issues of itself.
Yeah, and let's be clear. Missouri had already started to take away our voting rights with voter ID, whether Trump became president or not. And so they've been introducing that bill for the past 10 years, and a couple of times they got it passed and it got vetoed. Now it's law. And so there are some efforts.
Now, when you say it's law,
the photo ID law.
Photo ID law.
It is law. But now that it is, even though there are some coalitions that plan on attacking it in the court, you know, I think that we have an earnest to be trying to make sure that everybody who's eligible that don't have ID, that's minority, get ID. I don't want to rely on the courts to turn it around. My point is we need, and they need ID anyway, so we need to be doing, and the state is supposed to pay for it, and so we need to be doing more to make sure that, and we do as much as possible, and we're going to continue to say, people, if you don't have ID, go ahead, get ID. The state is going to pay for it because we don't want you to lose your voting rights.
I know that's right. So that's one of the key campaigns that the NAACP will be focusing on going forward.
And then the other one is this.
But let me stop you. If somebody out in the audience want to be on board with helping the NAACP, how would they get in contact?
Call us at 314-361-8600.
Would you say it again?
314-361-8600.
And that's for making sure that the voting rights of people are protected, as well as getting our economic inclusion.
And as a matter of fact, if you know of anybody who do not have an ID but want to get one, call us.
And again, when you say call, one more time.
314-361-8600.
Okay, now going to the other issue, you know, in the St. Louis area, you know, we've had some real hot spot issues around police, and nationally there's been a lot of issues around the police. In fact, I just saw a documentary that if people happen to come across a call, LA 92, dealing with taken place after the Rodney King beating, should try to make sure that they see that. On the issue of policing, you know, St. Louis City is now getting ready to have a new police chief. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've had some hot issues around that, as mm-hmm. I just mentioned. Mm-hmm. So what kind of work does NAACP do around that whole issue of policing?
You know, what...
Oh, but can you just hold that thought?
Sure.
We got to take a break,
sure,
and then
okay.
we'll come back.
What do you mean by crushing my people and grinding the faces of the poor, says the Lord God of hosts, Isaiah 3:15. He who oppresses the poor reproaches his maker, but he who honors him has mercy on the needy. Proverbs 14:31. Wash yourself, make yourself clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do good. Seek justice, rebuke the oppressor, defend the fatherless, and plead for the widow. Isaiah 1:16-17. You shall not afflict any widow and fatherless child. If you afflict them in any way, and they cry at all to me, I will swiftly hear their cry. Exodus 22:22-23. Who executes justice for the oppressed? Who gives food to the hungry? The Lord gives freedom to the prisoners. Psalm 146:7.
Hello, I'm Larry Rice, and we certainly need your support here at the New Life Evangelistic Center, as we were the last major walk-in shelter in mid-America. And the Slay administration, when it exit officed, its last major act was to shut down, cease and desist the services of 14 Lemon Locust. Well, we're getting right back in there. We're going to be fixing up certain things. We're working through the legal process. God willing, we're going to have our daytime services taking place right away as we continue to work through the courts to get back to providing emergency services. But your prayers are needed at the New Life Evangelistic Center. We have an urgent need for ongoing monies for our legal expenses and repairs. Please send those gifts to the New Life Evangelistic Center at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, that's 63166. And please continue to pray for us here at the New Life Evangelistic Center as we continue to work to be there when people are hurting.
You're back with Zaki Baruti, Conversations with Zaki Baruti, and we're in studio with Adolphus Pruitt. Real quickly, in terms of NAACP position on policing.
Yeah, no, the bottom line is this. The only thing that's going to really help us more than anything else as relates to policing is find a way to police the police. And we got to get the police within the police department to be just as dogmatic about policing themselves than anything else. And that's why we work with Alderman Williams to get the whistleblower bill. It was passed into law. We wrote it. The Board of Aldermen passed it. We had to find a way to protect police officers who are in the department who are willing to testify and spill the beans on the other police in the department that are doing wrong. Otherwise, unless we have body cameras and all this other stuff that captures this stuff at the moment in time, we still need to have the good police willing to help clean up their department and testify and spill the beans on the bad ones so we can get them up out of there.
So with that said, and we only have a couple minutes
sure.
left, for those who are out there listening, you wanted to give them a message in terms of their responsibility, what would be your message to our listening audience?
You know, the everybody has, you know, I'm my brother's keeper. Everybody has a responsibility to look and see what is it that they can contribute to address any of these myriad of problems that are going on in our community and going on in the world, period. And we all have to pick our own poison and decide which one of those efforts we're going to become a part of and help. Because every little bit helps. But if you sit at home or you sit somewhere and you're not doing anything to help address any of these problems, that's a problem.
And you know what? I just want to add on in terms of it's the responsibility, as you say, that everyone out here are to be their brothers and sisters' keepers,
yes,
you know,
sure.
especially if you say you're a Christian or a Muslim
yeah.
or whatever. And then also we have to make it a badge of honor, in our humble opinion, of two things. One, it is a duty to vote
yes.
in every election. And then secondly, to belong to an organization that's about the upliftment of our people. There's a whole number of organizations that's out here, including the NAACP. Again, your number in case anybody's interested.
314-361-8600. It can be the church. It can be the school. It can be your PTA. Anything. Just do something.
Do something. And I appreciate that. On that note, you have been listening to Conversations with Zaki Baruti.